Everybody, I'm Katie, the official pastoral resident. Thanks for giving them all my title. So I've always wanted to be a resident, you know, it's something. Maybe med school, that didn't work out, so doing the pastoral thing. No, it's actually the greatest gift. I'm in seminary at Fuller, learning a lot because of what you guys are doing. It's just an incredible opportunity to be up here. So before I jump into the sermon, I'm just going to pray really quickly. So bow your heads. Lord, just thank you so much for the opportunity to come to you in gratitude, to seek your face, to listen to your voice, to follow your will for our lives, to see how you have uniquely designed us and created us for just really incredible adventures with you, Lord. And we just humbly present ourselves for the next 20, 30 minutes to continue worshiping you with our minds and our hearts as we prepare them to hear your word. And we love you, and it's in your son's name we pray. Amen. Okay, so I just have to tell you this, because sometimes it's easier to just go ahead and get things out of the way early. Sometimes when I feel like spiritual gifting-wise, the whole thing of standing in front of a group and monologuing for 20 to 30 minutes is like the weirdest spiritual gift, and also not one that, you know, you'd be like, oh, I want this one. It's like, it kind of feels like sometimes it was the last one left, and you're like, okay, I think I can do that. You know, I was a goalkeeper in field hockey in college, and I fell into that position, and it was something that I never saw myself doing, but then the more I did it, the more I realized that I felt strong in that position of anxiety and intensity, and every time I get up to speak, it feels like pregame, and all those same nerves are there, and all that same anxiety, but all that same excitement, and now it's a holy excitement, because it's not just an opponent in front of us, it's family, it's church, and it's the opportunity to seek God together, so it's a real gift, and I'm still learning how to put it on and get comfortable in it, but I appreciate you guys being willing to listen. So today we are talking about gratitude, and we're going to have a little bit of a roadmap to gratitude, discussing the why of gratitude, the how of gratitude, a thief, one of many thieves to gratitude, and a practice of gratitude, or a little gratitude homework for the week. I won't say homework because I'm in seminary. I have enough of that. But a gratitude practice that we can participate in this week. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the why of gratitude. Researching for this message was not hard. Gratitude has become a hot topic even in pop psychology and in even the non-Christian or non-faith-based world. People are realizing that there's a science behind gratitude, that gratitude leads to happiness, and these things lower your blood pressure and ease anxiety and promote better relationships, and that grateful people are more patient and they sleep better and they're less likely to suffer from depression. And it's like, wow, so gratitude is linked to these things that help our human bodies and minds to flourish. And, you know, before I became a Christian, I was like, cool, I can focus on gratitude. I'll write down things I'm grateful for or situations I'm grateful for. And it was kind of like, though, a bit of a dry well, because if I looked around my life and I hadn't had a great day, it was, you know, then you just felt like you were just making stuff up, like, well, I guess I'm grateful for, you know. And it was that kind of superficial gleaning for gratitude. And it's a lot like, I was listening to a sermon, it was a lot like a superficial apology, like, I'm really grateful for, you know. I couldn't really go much deeper than my circumstances, because that was where my joy and gratitude was based. And in 1 Thessalonians, which is that same verse we heard a little bit earlier, it reads, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. So Paul's telling the church here that it is God's will that they be grateful, that they continue to praise despite the circumstance. But again, if you don't know God, then how do you praise outside of circumstance? When things are really hard, or when something is going wrong in your life and you're seeing your own flaws or sins, how do you not become defensive? How do you not become aggressive? How do you not have anger or malice? How can you truly be grateful when you get that mirror that's showing you who you are and you don't like what you see, or you're participating in a world where things aren't going great? It's almost impossible to tap into something deeper. You just kind of go into that waiting, holding pattern for something good to happen that you can, you know, breathe. I'm grateful now. Because finally, conditionally, I have that sense of gratitude. And so as I was kind of researching, something I came across that is different between, I think, the world's view of gratitude and a Christian's view of gratitude is that our gratitude is not rooted in our condition. It is rooted in our disposition. So our disposition, which Paul points to, is that we give thanks in all things. And so, okay, sounds easy enough, right? So we're Christians, and I think one of the hardest things when I first became a Christian was a lot of people telling me, like, okay, just pray through that. That sounds difficult, but it'll be okay. God uses all things. And at times, that didn't feel like really enough, to be honest, because I wasn't fully rooted in my relationship with Christ. So giving praise through difficult situations seemed kind of superficial and kind of like we were just silver linings over the whole thing. And I think as Christians, we sometimes jump to that place, like, it'll be okay, just give thanks, just praise. But as I've walked with God longer and deeper, I've come to a place of realizing that we can seek that deeper gratitude because that's where our identity is resting. And I would kind of challenge ourselves to consider that if we're walking around with a spirit of ingratitude, for me, when I am in that place, I have forgotten who I am in Christ and what he's done for me. Because my story is there's a really, you know, very stark dividing line between pre-Christ and meeting God. And when I see and am able to remember and see what he has done and who I've become since accepting him into my life and making him Lord and not just buddy or friend or moral teacher or, you know, come along for the ride guy, but truly Savior. When I got to that place, too, of realizing that I needed that, was actually when the gratitude began to flow. And it's wild because part of my story and part of the first few years of my walk with God, I was heavily involved in a recovery community here in Wilmington. And I can still tell you that's one of my favorite churches in the whole wide world because the level of gratitude from folks who have been in deep darkness, in deep bondage, in deep hardship, to finally be walking in some level of light. It's like if anybody's a gardener and you've got that plant that's been shriveling and you forgot where it was and then you find it and then you put it just in the sunlight and it's like it sighs and it reaches and it breathes and it moves forward and it bends towards the light. That's what those rooms were like, watching actual souls begin to bend and move towards the light. And the immense gratitude, the immense suffering and hardship that you'd see every time you entered was palpable, but also this sense of folks who had experienced death, who had come to life, and were so thankful for everything. Thankful for the coffee, which was never good, and thankful for the air, even though it was usually too cold, and thankful for the friends and the rides, and just everything that God was doing and restoring in their life. And I think that's it's a gift. You know, that desperation produces such a depth of gratitude that few people actually get to experience. And I think when we think about the gospel, I know when I tried Jesus on in college, I just was really interested in having somebody kind of co-sign my life and help me out with a few things. And like, I needed an entity to pray to when I, you know, before tests, basically. And so that was my view of God. He was very small and he was at my disposal, kind of. And I could just ask, like, genie in a bottle. I'd just ask, and he'd come out, and then I'd ask him to go back. But by the time I was ready to really explore who Jesus was, I was finally humbled. I think I'd gotten a real dose of who I was in light of the world. Things weren't going perfectly anymore. And my coaches always used to say that you really see what you're made of when you don't win. And for the first time in my life, I'd experienced some pretty serious losses, and I was getting a real good glimpse of what my character was inside of that and who I was inside of that. And like I said, that led me to a level of desperation and willingness to not just say, Jesus, okay, genie in a bottle, Jesus, let's go help me before my test, but Jesus, like, who are you? I want to know you. And that process, you know, gratitude didn't root overnight. But when I realized through Scripture who he really was, what he really did, and what that really meant for my life going forward, the amount of gratitude that began to, I would say it's almost like a soil. It's something so much deeper than the topsoil, but it started kind of welling up from deep, 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 deep in. And this realization, this foundation that I can be grateful in all things because of what he's done years before I ever knew him, and therefore I can be free from the things that held me hostage, free from, but also free to live this entirely unique life If you knew me before meeting God, the last thing I'd be doing is standing up here preaching a sermon. And so the reality that I've gotten to be invited into this process, this walk with God, is something I'm deeply grateful for. I want to talk a little bit more about gratitude and the how of gratitude. There's another verse, actually, that follows this one. James 1:17. It's going to echo what we read earlier. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. You know, I listened to a sermon that kind of unpacked that for me, and I was like, how does that have anything to do with gratitude? And what the author of that sermon said is that we go around the world, or our lives, right, with like a label maker. And when things happen to us, we say, that was good. Ooh, that was bad. Oh, that was okay. And that was not so okay. Like, I liked that. Oh, that one's not so great. And this idea that everything that happens can be a gift, even the difficult things, even the character-building things, even the hard things, even the mysterious things, can be used for something unforeseen in our lives and the lives of others. And that we don't actually have to walk around with the label maker and live and die by what we think is going on, but we can just rest and trust that somebody else has it under control. And I'm not trying to minimize suffering, because some things are bad, and they're truly hard, and it doesn't seem like there's any kernel of good in them. But I think what Jesus does in those times is we have to go even deeper into understanding his character and his love and his will and understanding and being a part of his suffering, not that we could ever know, but knowing that he suffered too, and that our suffering produces perseverance and cultivates character and draws us closer to God. Because I don't know about you, but when things are going well and it's up and to the right and the blessings are flowing, it's kind of like I'm high-fiving God and running on my own direction. But when things start getting hard, man, I find my face to the floor. And I don't like that posture. I was a college athlete, you know. But this idea of humbling myself, to seek God and rest and need him desperately, often comes through those hard times. And so when we get a imperfect gift, and we don't have to say, this is horrible, this is worthless, I don't know what's going to become of this, but we can just say, I accept it, I trust Jesus, you in this, and please cultivate in me a grateful heart because of it. Allow me to use this hard thing, perhaps, to connect with somebody else. Allow it to strengthen me to build up or lift up someone else in the future, but ultimately just carry me through it. You know that, you know, my grandma, this is, oh, tangent. This is not in the notes. Oh, no. abort mission. It's too late. So when I was growing up, my grandma, she had a real crazy life, and I always heard stories about her crazy parties and stuff. And then there was apparently like a point in time where everything must have changed, because the grandma I knew wasn't wild, wasn't reckless, wasn't out of control, was a lot of fun, always generous, grateful, one of the most grateful people I ever knew. Just so full of life and joy and could find a blessing in anything. And it was like she walked through a whole day like everything was just a cherry on top. You know, you walk outside and there was rain and she was like, the plants are going to love this. And you'd be like, oh gosh, you know, no, we're not, I don't care about the plants, I just need a raincoat. And she had gotten to a place where all the hardships, I think, that had happened in her life and had culminated in an ability for her to be grateful in things beyond her circumstance. And also to have that sense of perspective that only comes from experiencing really hard things and trusting God in them. And so it's amazing when you meet people like that. They're humble and they're generous. And they lavish their gifts generously, and they're always praising. You know, I think one of the things we see in the world is praise, and then we see pride. We see people who think everything's good because they earned it, and they got there on their own, and they probably deserved it anyways. And we see folks who see the whole world as a gift. And a quote that I heard just today before coming up here was that gratitude makes everything that you have enough. You live out of that place of deep satisfaction so that, just like my grandma, everything can be a cherry on top. And it doesn't mean you don't have expectations or expectancy, but you've been met and fulfilled before you even get to them, if that makes sense. And so you get to share what you have because it doesn't, there's no scarcity mindset kind of wrapped up in it. Real quick on a thief of gratitude, there's so many. I think one of the main ones that I'm not even going to talk about is comparison. You know, when we sit there and we say, well, but I should, or they should, or I wish I had, or and ultimately that takes us back to our identity in Christ. Because if we truly believe that we got everything we ever needed on the cross, then everything that happens after that is just gravy. And that entitlement kind of etches away. But I think another thief of gratitude, and this is kind of a little bit hard to articulate, is our inability to lament. I don't know if anybody's an Enneagram person. I know there's a few of you out there. So this is personality test. It's kind of popular in the Christian world right now. And my personality is entirely pain avoidant. I go the other way. I am very interested in having a good time. And, like, call me if it's sunny. If it's raining, I'm already looking at flights to Costa Rica. So I just truly, like, I don't want to sit in that, you know. So having to go through really hard seasons for the whole second half of my 20s was, like, the most excruciating thing ever. But that's literally what it took to drive me to seek Jesus. And I think one of our thieves to gratitude is our inability to go there, to go to that painful, lamenting place. And we sometimes say, it'll be okay. We do that silver linings thing when, you know, it'll be fine. And we see somebody going through a hard thing. We say, you know, but, you know, next week it'll be better, or you know, I'll pray for you, but which is amazing. But what does it look like to really step into somebody else's pain? Because you're not scared of it, and it's not going to define you. It's not going to let, you're going to help them not be defined by it themselves, but that you can truly come into that season of hardness in your own heart and life and also in other people's. Because one, that's the gospel and is so glorifying to God when we come alongside people who are hurting. But two, when we don't do that, we rob ourselves of the depth of gratitude. I mean, has anybody ever gone camping and then that first shower when you get home, right? I mean, seriously, like, you never knew showers were so good until you didn't have a shower for 3 days. Or you're starving and you get that meal. Or you didn't think you were going to get that job and then you did. But whatever it was that you sat in that place of lament or hardship or pain, it provides such praise for when that joy comes along. And yeah, it's hard not to hold our entire identity on whether or not we got that joy met. But truly, to be able to sit in the hard thing makes us so much more full and able to receive the blessing, if that makes sense. It's kind of long, but I kind of want to read you a few lines from a poem by Khalil Gibran. And, you know, gratitude is so closely linked to joy, and grief is so closely linked to sorrow or lament. And in this poem on joy and sorrow, he writes, and the deeper the sorrow that carves into your being, the more joy you can contain. Is it not the cup that holds your wine, the very thing that was burned in the potter's oven? And is not the lute that soothes your spirit, the very wood that was hollowed with knives? When you are joyous, look deep into your heart, and you shall find that it is only that which has given you sorrow that is giving you joy. And I know we all have been through seasons of loss, and it's hard to imagine that part of why that is so painful is because it was so great. You experienced such a deep joy or gratitude that now you experience an equal measure of grief. And so I think the point being that when we are able to hold the grief because it doesn't define us and we can sit there with Jesus, we also have perspective and ability to really savor the gratitude when it comes to, because we're balanced equally in Christ. I'm going to jump ahead to the gratitude practice, the homework. Before I even say that, though, I want you to just take the next 10 seconds and think of something in your life that you're deeply grateful for. Maybe it's a person, maybe it's a place, maybe it's something you've just gone through or something that you're looking forward to, but something that you're deeply grateful for. And just kind of hold that in your mind. And maybe it's a positive thing. Because the next thing I want you to think about is something that's ridiculously hard that you've gone through, that has shaped you or forged you or broken you. And are we able to be grateful for that too? Are we able to sit with that and see Jesus in that and hold on to it without it consuming us, if that makes sense? Because that ability to have both and be grateful for both is, I think, one of the greatest gifts that Jesus gives us. And because our roots are so much deeper than our circumstance, we can kind of grow through those circumstances as they happen. And they continue to push us towards Christ, whether they're a blessing, kind of helping us grow out, or they are a burden, helping us to see where we need to tuck in. Both are being used to form us and shape us in his image. So the gratitude practice for this week is to write a letter. And this can be private. This is strange, but after my mom passed away, I created an email account for her and for Jesus. They go to a different email, but that I have the password for, but it allowed me to keep writing. Because for a really long time, as my faith was being forged, I needed to write both of them every day. And so I wrote Jesus because, I mean, I was a new Christian. I figured email would be the easiest way to get to him. I wasn't so comfortable in prayer yet. So I'd send these emails to, you know, I owned a business, so I had the back end part of it. So I'd send these emails, and it really became like an ongoing gratitude journal. And it was really cool to hack back into that email. About every year I go and I reread all those things I sent God in those early days, things I was grateful for when the trees of my life were just barely budding again, and my incredible gratitude for the littlest things that I probably take for granted now. And just the ability to keep cultivating that gratitude. I mean, like my grandma, I never want to lose that, if possible, but the world kind of tries to dampen it and put a fog around it, and you forget that it's a gift even to just be standing on our own and breathing and walking and living the lives we've been given. And so this gratitude practice, write a letter to God for thanking him, and maybe not so much for a blessing that he's bestowed, but for who he is to you, for part of his character, for part of the joy you receive from knowing Christ, but just this idea of connecting with God and being grateful just for who he is. Because I think so many times we connect the gratitude with the blessing and not the blesser. And it's a gift to just go straight to God with that gratitude. And then the other, later in the week, if you'd like to do so, would be to write a letter to somebody expressing gratitude for who they are in your life. Again, avoid the what they did or what they've done, but just for who they are. Because I think so often we love people because they do this or do they do that. But any parent knows that you love just because they are, not because of what they're doing. And so the ability to love a friend that way or love family that way or a coworker is just such a gift and reorients our heart from that performance-based, I'm grateful because condition to I'm grateful because that's who God's made me to be. I'm grateful because of what his son's done in my life, and so everything else, that blessing that flows, it just flows from that love first and foremost. I had a lot more quotes in here, but I'm going to end on one from C.S. Lewis. It's really short, and so just take a minute and kind of sit on it. C.S. Lewis wrote in one of his books actually on grief, and he talks about gratitude and its role in grief, and he says that gratitude is basically fixing one's mind on the sunbeam, so seeing the sunbeam come down from the clouds, and you're looking at the sunbeam, and you run it all the way back up to the sun. And so when things happen in our lives, and that feels warm, that feels nice, that feels good, but instead we are able to run up the sunbeam right to God and be grateful to him. So when somebody's so kind, we know that it's their kindness, which is a gift from God. And when a circumstance just works out perfectly, it wasn't because always our timing was immaculate. Maybe it's because of his timing that was immaculate. And being able to just run up that sunbeam to the source, the giver of all the gifts and the blessings, and to just rest in the gratitude that produces in our hearts. One more quote, this one I came up with.
gotta find it on this page. Gratitude is the soil from which grace grows and the well from which love flows. So soil needs to be deep and it needs to be rich. It needs to be fertile. And these are all things Christ cultivates in us through relationship with him. And a well that's pure and good, I'm pretty sure, I'm not a farm person, but I think they're deep, you know, because they tap down into these aquifers and these springs and they go to somewhere that we can't see or touch. And they draw up something so life-giving and pure that we get to consume ourselves and give to others. And so gratitude is that same thing, and it comes from God. And so we have to cultivate it and dig for it and dig deep into our circumstances to find the richness of it. So thank you guys so much for listening, and we're going to go ahead and have a time of prayer for the congregation.